This is the Aston Martin 177. Compared to Vantage and Vanquish, it is a rubbish name, and frankly the car deserves better, because it is the most powerful and most expensive Aston Martin of all time. At the front is a 7.3-litre V12 making 700 horsepower, which would be remarkable on its own. But it's even more amazing when you discover that this car weighs less than Aston's own V8 Vantage. They ran the 177 prototype up to 220 miles an hour before the driver backed off. According to Aston, it could go even faster. Whether you'd want to is another matter. Firstly, because it costs £1.3 million, and it would be a shame to break it. And secondly, because, well, just look at it. The underneath of the 177 is made from huge, beautiful sheets of carbon fiber, copied from Aston Martin's Le Mans races. And on top is a hand-beaten aluminium skin made by the same 200-year-old men who've been making Aston Martins since 1913. If only it had a better name. The 1930 Bentley 8-litre could have become one of the world's greatest cars, like the gargantuan Bugatti Royale. But it was launched in London in 1930 with a price of £1,850. Back then, that was a lot. Especially since at almost exactly the same time, the Great Depression arrived in Europe. As a result, only 100 8-litres were ever made, and the car's failure brought Bentley to its knees. Within a year, it was sold to Rolls-Royce. Of those 100, only 78 are left, and every one is unique. This was a time when companies like Bentley sold you the bottom half of a car, the chassis, engine and wheels, and then left you to find a coach builder for the body and the seats and the roof. So, this car shares its huge 220 horsepower, 6-cylinder engine and 21-inch wheels with all the other 8-litres, but the rest, that was always a one-off. On this one, for example, the roof opens down the middle, so when it rains, those on the left could opt to get wet, while those on the right could stay dry. Strangely, it was an idea that didn't catch on, just like the rest of the Bentley 8-litres. A normal BMW 5 Series can be as interesting as travelling to Switzerland to buy some socks. But this isn't a normal 5 Series. This is the brand new BMW M5. Like previous versions of the M5, you wouldn't know it's anything out of the ordinary, unless you're an industrial-strength Class 1 ocean-going car bore. There are slightly swollen arches, fractionally bigger air intakes, and a set of subtle vents in the wings. But overall, it looks like the 520 that your dentist drives. And that's always been the genius of M5s, right back to the original of 1985. They may look quiet and unassuming, but they go like a stabbed badger. And this new one should be no exception. Gone is the rather droney V10 from the old M5, and in its place is a 4.4-litre twin-turbocharged V8, making over 550 horsepower. The pointlessly complicated and stupidly annoying gearbox of the old car has gone too, to be replaced by a 7-speed double-clutch flappy paddle system that should make changes as silky as Pierce Brosnan's underpants. So, it's as discreet as a Victorian butler, yet it's powerful enough to pop a kidney. It is, in short, another classic BMW M5. Above 155 miles an hour, they stop trying to classify Hurricanes. 155 miles an hour is a Category 5, the kind that killed 12,000 burly Texans in 1900. There is no Category 6, because if there was, there'd be nobody left to classify it once it had passed. The Bugatti Veyron will pass through the air at 252 miles an hour, so you have some idea of the forces of nature at work here, and the reasons why it needs to haul that vast aeroplane wing into the airstream to keep it stable. It's also why it needs 16 cylinders, 8 litres, 4 turbochargers, 10 radiators, and 1,000 horsepower. Everything about this car is Category 6. Except that is the skill level required to drive it. Your mother could. A flappy paddle gearbox developed by people who develop Formula One gearboxes, and a four-wheel drive system developed with some considerable amount of head-scratching by rocket scientists means you just get in and drive. And you won't drive anything faster. Anything. Like Concorde and the Saturn V, the Veyron is the furthest its particular engineering avenue will be explored. The men who engineered it are probably working now on hydrogen propulsion. There is no longer a place in the world for a car that will, with a twist of the special extra key required to dial in that hurricane-beating top speed, consume a set of 10,000-pound tyres in just 300 miles. And that makes me sad. Naming a car company after yourself is fine if you're called Ferrari or Pagani or Lamborghini or even Morgan. It's not such a good idea if your last name is something stupid like Shufflebottom or Death. Unfortunately, this is advice that was ignored by a German man called Roland Gumpert. And here is the result. The Gumpert Apollo S. However, despite the stupid name, when this strange-looking car came to our test track, it lapped quicker than anything, including the original Veyron. But then that's not entirely surprising when you learn that it's basically a racing car with headlights and a twin-turbo Audi V8 that in basic tune makes 650 horsepower. That's enough for 0-60 in less than 3 seconds and a top speed of 223. Better yet, there's the option to tweak it up to 800 horsepower. And plans are afoot to launch a version with 1,000 horsepower. So that's the Gumpert Apollo. Silly name, serious car. There's a famous scene from the first Gulf War when a convoy of Humvees enters a minefield. One of them hits a mine, gets blown clean in the air, lands on all four wheels, and continues on. That is not possible in a Land Rover. It was at this moment that the Hummer legend was born. And someone quickly figured out that there were enough crazed gym enthusiasts in California to justify making the Humvee available to non-military types. Fitting the Humvee into civvies meant replacing the 6.5-litre Detroit diesel engine with a 6.6-litre GM Duramax. And since this engine made just 300 horsepower in a car that weighs more than most houses, it was often quicker to walk to the shops than use the Hummer. Still, if between you and the shops was a 22-inch obstacle to be cleared, or a puddle 30 inches deep, or a minefield, the Hummer H1 was the car for you. These turned out to be obstacles that most people don't face, and as a result, the H1 Alpha was discontinued after just over a year. You might think Ferraris should be mid-engined, and this one isn't. You might think Ferraris should have V12s, and this one doesn't. It's called the California, and you have to ask, what's the point of it? Certainly, it's not very pretty, and it has literally the worst built-in telephone of any car in the world. Unless, of course, you've always wanted to spend your life accidentally phoning everyone you know whose name starts with A. But on the plus side, it's got a folding metal roof, it's reasonably nice to drive, and it means Ferrari can take money from people who might previously have bought a Mercedes SL, which means they can afford to develop proper, wonderful supercars like the 458. So, you see, the California does have a point, after all. This is the very latest mid-engined V8 Ferrari, the 458 Italia. Pretty, isn't it? And that's not something you can say about many of their efforts from the last few years. The 430 had a front end like a leering idiot. The 348 looked like it had crashed into a Venetian blind showroom. But this looks just right. Its appearance isn't just for show either. Those black fins in the front grille flex under air pressure, so the faster you go, the more they bend out of the way to improve aerodynamics. And there are no engine intakes to spoil the sides because they've been moved underneath the car. So it looks fantastic, and its 4.5-litre, 562-horsepower V8 means it has the guts to punch you repeatedly in the back of the head. But that alone wouldn't be enough. Some of its ancestors have been as incompetent and terrifying as having brain surgery performed by a baboon. As it turns out, the 458 is better than that. Much better. In fact, it's a sharp-handling, smooth-riding, savagely fast masterpiece. Of course, it's not perfect. For some reason, they've put far too many buttons on the steering wheel. The dashboard screens are so complicated they can only be worked by Bill Gates, and personally, I'd still rather have the brutal Mercedes SLS. But I can't deny that the 458 is a great car and a proper, proper Ferrari. This is only the third Ferrari in history to be called a GTO. The first, the 1962 250 GTO, remains the world's most valuable and quite possibly the world's most beautiful car. But its form came from its main function, as a racer. Likewise, GTO number 2, the 288 of the 1980s, was also made to go racing, only for the rules to change at the last minute, leaving it with nowhere to race. And now we have this, the third GTO, a slightly softened road-going version of the 599 FXX. It has 670 horsepower and a sense that it's constantly plotting new and exciting ways to physically harm you. But that's not the only reason why I don't much care for this car. The real reason I'm no fan is because the O in GTO means homologation. It means racing. And this 599 will never race, nor was it ever intended to. In essence, then, it's just a lightened, pumped-up version of the car a successful plastic surgeon would drive. In Italy, you don't take the name of the father in vain. So when Ferrari decided to call this car the Enzo, you knew they had something special in mind. Something that would take supercars onto another level of speed, of handling, of fury. Such fury that after three full-bore standing starts, you have to send the car back to Italy for a new clutch. The Ferrari Enzo marked the point at which supercars became like modern fighter jets, demanding complicated electronics to keep them under control. It's computers that keep its 6-litre, 660 brake horsepower V12 and flappy paddle gear shift on speaking terms, and its F1 style adjustable suspension on an even footing. The result is a car that's faster around Ferrari's test track than all but their most recent Formula One cars. The Enzo's V12 went on to even greater things in the insane FXX and the psychotic 599 GTO, both cars that need even more men with laptops to keep them under control. But for Ferrari, the Enzo was genesis. They only made 399 of them, and then the factory built a 400th for a very particular customer, the Pope. That's how special you have to have one. Back in 1995, Ferrari had a problem. How could they follow the extreme and extremely wonderful F40? The answer was this, the F50. A road-going Ferrari with the V12 engine from a Formula One car bolted in the back. Except as it turned out, it didn't feel bolted in the back. It felt bolted to your back. As a result, the abiding memory for anyone who drove an F50 wasn't the ferocious acceleration or the 200-mile-an-hour top speed. It was the sense that you'd had a furiously spinning washing machine full of bricks hammering directly into your most sensitive pain receptors. Add in the fact that it liked to bite back in the corners, and what you've got here is actually the recipe for 4.7 litres of total misery. It was a very bad car, and it was ugly. Still, at least it made them try harder with the Enzo. If you wanted to win at Le Mans at the end of the 1950s, you needed to be driving one of these. The Ferrari 250 Testarossa wasn't just beautiful, it was frighteningly effective. It dominated the 24-hour race in 1958 and again in 1960. And then, just for good measure, when the opposition thought it could breathe again, it won again in 1961. Its close cousin, the 250 GTO, might be the most valuable car the world has ever seen, but the Testarossa was the one that took the silverware. For all its beauty, the GTO had to make do with class wins, where the Testarossa beat everything. Its name comes from the red paint the engine builders daubed all over its cylinder head, because, well, that's the only color paint they have at Ferrari. Testarossa means red head. And sure enough, its 3-litre V12 engine, made by old men in oily workshops with lathes and drills and unfortunate industrial injuries, had a volcanic nature. There is sweat and blood and a bad attitude in every Ferrari 250 Testarossa. Everyone knows American cars are terrible, and cars from Europe, especially cars from Italy, are better. Better looking, better driving, and usually better sounding. 50 years ago, Henry Ford knew this. That's why he tried to buy Ferrari, and thought he had. Until Enzo Ferrari looked down his Roman nose and said, you know what? Actually, you can't have it. So, Henry decided to kick Ferrari where it hurt, on the racetrack. He wrote a blank check and told his engineers to build a better racing car and beat Ferrari at Le Mans. And astonishingly, that car, a British chassis with an American engine, the Ford GT40, did just that. 4 times. This car is not the GT40, but it looks like one. And it was made to celebrate Ferrari's humiliation, only this time on the road, not the track. It's the Ford GT, not the GT40, because unlike that car, it's more than 40 inches tall, so Americans could fit into it. But the idea is just the same. A great big V8, a 5.4 litre with a supercharger, and a relatively simple aluminium chassis. 220 miles an hour, and frankly, astonishing handling for a car from America. And movie star looks. I have never driven a car that attracts more attention, and I drove this one a lot, because I bought one as remarkably, at the time, there wasn't a Ferrari that was better. And that's only something that happens once every 50 years. If you think the Lamborghini Murcielago isn't rare or special enough, this is the car for you. It's called the Rebenton. And if you think it looks like an F-22 Raptor stealth fighter, you'd be right. That was the idea. Except on the Raptor, all the strange surfaces and matte black paint are meant to make it look more discreet. But this car is a Lamborghini. And Lamborghini doesn't know the meaning of discreet. Certainly, there's nothing even remotely discreet about the monstrous 6.5-litre, 640 horsepower V12. Firing that up is like strapping a unicorn to the roof and driving around shouting, "Look at me!" through a loud hailer. Mind you, frankly, you've more chance of seeing a unicorn than seeing a Rebenton. Because Lamborghini made just 20 of them. Although if you do see one, you'll almost certainly remember it. This is a Lexus. I know, doesn't look like one, does it? It doesn't sound like a Lexus from the details either. I mean, it has a 4.8-litre, 552 brake horsepower V10. It also has a carbon fibre body. And it does 0-60 in 3.7 seconds and has a top speed of 200 miles an hour. This is what happens when you tell Lexus engineers to stop making quiet, dull saloons for people who play golf, let off the leash, they go mad and make this, the LFA. A car that sounds like an F1 racer and goes like a Ferrari 458, as it should when you discover that it costs twice as much. But just to prove they haven't forgotten their insane attention to detail, the Lexus boffins have given it dashboard vents that gently waft from side to side to make sure the air is evenly distributed around the cabin. This is a Lexus in the same sense that I'm a 400-meter runner. In other words, it isn't a Lexus at all. What this is Toyota showing exactly what they're capable of. And it turns out that what they're capable of is quite a lot. Before the Bugatti Veyron, there was this, the 241-mile-an-hour McLaren F1. Despite its similar top speed, the McLaren F1 is the very opposite of the Veyron. No turbochargers, no four-wheel drive, no traction control, no ABS, and no flappy paddle electronically controlled gearbox. In spirit, the McLaren is closer to a Caterham than a Bugatti. A Caterham with a gold-plated engine compartment. It was built without compromise, and nothing was to get in the way of the driving experience. That's why the driver sits in the middle, so they feel completely in control. McLaren was so determined to use this layout, they even had the law changed to make it possible. Then there's the 627 brake horsepower 6.1-litre V12 engine, built specially for this car by a crack team of BMW Motorsport engineers, and the bespoke gearbox and a body made of carbon fibre. We take that for granted in supercars now, but back in the early 90s, it was so extraordinary they might as well have made it from lumps of Jupiter. Personally, I've never cared that much for the F1. It was too twitchy. But without it, Bugatti wouldn't have had something to aim for, and we wouldn't have had the incredible Veyron. In that respect, we owe McLaren our thanks. This is not just the greatest car Mercedes makes. Right now, I think it's the greatest car in the world. It's more powerful than a Ferrari 458, just. It's a little bit louder than a Lamborghini, and it's way more fun than the 911 RS GT Turbo 3S, or whatever this week's Ultimate Beetle is called. This is the thinking men's supercar, the Mercedes SLS. The engine is AMG's own 6.2-litre V8 linked to a flappy paddle double-clutch gearbox that sits at the back for perfect weight distribution, so that it feels as though the entire car pivots around, well, around your bottom. It does a lot of pivoting, if truth be told, because while it can do huge distances in great comfort, what it is at heart is a shouty, snarly, tail-happy, gull-winged lunatic. And that is why I love it. This is the greatest Anglo-German cooperation since, ever. It's the Mercedes-Benz SLR McLaren. From Germany, the big badge on the front, and the 5.4-litre supercharged V8 that gives this car 626 horsepower and a top speed of 208 miles an hour. From England comes the grey and silver, biros in the top pocket, engineering know-how of the McLaren F1 team, who came up with the carbon fibre body and built the whole thing in their Surrey factory. As you might imagine, the marriage between these two companies from these two nations was not easy. Mercedes insisted the SLR had to be front-engined and look exactly like this. McLaren insisted this was not ideal for a supercar. Mercedes wanted a comfortable, well-equipped cruiser. McLaren wanted a hardcore, lightweight racer. The two sides couldn't even agree on what the SLR sounded like at full chat. Mercedes said it was like a Messerschmitt. The British reckoned it was more like a Spitfire. Yet, despite the disagreements, the end result was a very fine car. Monstrously fast and loud when you drove like you'd sat on a bee, yet relaxed and easy to live with when you didn't. The only real problem were the carbon brakes, which worked like a switch. But whatever, the SLR is dead now and the two firms behind it have gone their separate ways. Although strangely, Mercedes now make the SLS, a hardcore cruiser, and McLaren, the MP4 12C, a civilized supercar. Which is somehow slightly ironic. This cross-eyed curiosity is a Morgan Aero Supersports. As with all Morgans, much of the structure is made from wood. And if that sounds laughably old-fashioned, well, it is. It's also still made in the Malvern Hills of England in a factory so caught in the past that when a propeller aircraft passes overhead, half the workforce jumps. Surprisingly, the engine in this car isn't made from mud and leaves. It's actually a BMW V8 that makes a rather modern 368 horsepower, allowing this half-timbered sports car to get from 0 to 60 in 4.5 seconds. It'll even run on to 170 miles an hour before its Edwardian aerodynamics prevent it going any faster. I said sports car, but in truth, this is as much a sports car as Westminster Abbey is a top-class rock and roll venue. This isn't a car to compete with modern Jaguars or Mercs or anything beyond. It's a strange time warp for people who believe cars should come with built-in nostalgia and a special kind of hat. And if that hasn't put you off the Aero Supersports, you should know that there's also a version with a fixed roof, one of which is owned by Richard Hammond. The idiot. The Koenigsegg CCX holds a special place in Top Gear history. For a long time, it was the fastest car around our track. To this day, it has the longest name of any car on our lap board. And it's the only car the Stig has ever stuffed. Stig's accident wasn't small, but then it wouldn't be with a 900 horsepower, twin supercharged, 4.5 litre V8 pushing him towards the tyre wall. But in a straight line, that power also means speed. 245 miles an hour to be exact, and that's not far off what a Veyron can do. Except, of course, a Veyron has a huge wing on it, as standard, and a Koenigsegg, as Stig found out, does not. Or at least it didn't until Stiggy's accident, after which it became an option for any owner who didn't fancy ruining the inside of their underpants. Even someone as fast and as brave as Stig would be wise to choose it. If you like your racing cars to sound like the God of Thunder treading on a drawing pin, you won't like the noise made by this, Peugeot's Le Mans winning 908, because it sounds rather like a vacuum cleaner. And the reason for this is because it runs on diesel. As dreary news goes though, this isn't as bad as it could be, because the diesel engine in question is a 5.5 litre twin turbo V12 with 730 horsepower and nearly 900 torques. That is a lot. And it means that even with a wing the size and length of a cocktail bar on the back, it can still reach over 250 miles an hour on the long Le Mans straights. The combination of speed and the fewer pit stops demanded by diesel economy mean Peugeot was a dead cert to win the 24-hour race in 2007. Except it didn't, because Audi fetched up with a diesel car that was even faster and even more reliable. The French plan didn't quite work in 2008 either, but by 2009, Peugeot got their act together to take a 1-2 Le Mans finish. Normal service was resumed in 2010. Spyker was a Dutch company that went out of business in 1925, apparently. Don't worry, I didn't know that either. I'd never heard of Spyker, nor its financial troubles, nor even that there was a motor industry in Holland. I'd always assumed they had other industries to be getting on with, like flowers or cheese. But then, a Dutch millionaire got bored with having too much money and bought Spyker back with cars like this, the C8 Laviolette LM85. It has a 4.2-litre V8 engine from Audi and a chassis that was developed with help from Lotus. But the really interesting thing about Spikers is the way they look, which is like nothing else, and their interiors, which are like something else, although in most cases that something else is an explosion in one of those shops that sells jewellery and expensive luggage. Spiker's millionaire owner says that's what people want, and presumably he's right. Because when most restarted car companies fail within 7 minutes, Spiker is now doing so well, it recently bought Saab. Eventually, all TVRs will break down, and now so has the company that made them. That's a shame. Nothing was a bad idea at TVR. They tried to reinvent the door handle. They made front wings that appear to have been attacked by a mad axeman. They got the company dog to help with the styling. Obviously, there was no guarantee that your TVR would start of a morning, and even less of a guarantee that once it was going, it wouldn't attempt to fling you into a field of sprouts. But the insanity was just part of what made TVRs so special. Given their inability to make anything work properly, it was yet another example of their madness that they made their own 4-litre straight-six engine. Still, in a car this light, it meant 0-60 in 3.7 seconds and a top speed of 185 miles an hour. TVRs were the snorting, grunting, swivel-eyed lunatics of the car world, and were somehow worse off without them. The Pagani Zonda, a car which proves that in Italy you can wake up one morning, drink one too many espressos, tell the world you're going to make a car as fast and as good as a Ferrari, and then actually go ahead and do it. This particular version, one of a baffling array of Zondas over the years, is the Cinque, a road-going version of the feral, track-only Zonda R. It's always puzzled us at Top Gear how Pagani makes its cars so good. Yes, they put in the effort by inventing a new cocktail of carbon fiber and titanium called carbotanium. And they managed to persuade Merck's power-crazed AMG division to build them special V12 engines. But that's not enough on its own. What Pagani really understand is that a supercar should be loud and dramatic, and fast enough to make your eyeballs turn to putty. They also make cars that are incredibly easy to drive. Many men in sheds try to make supercars, and they get it wrong. But Pagani, as we see here, consistently gets it right. Very, very right.